वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला, दिस इज अनन्या भट्टाचार्जी। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डू अ मॉड्यूल फ्रॉम द पेपर टाइटल्ड विमेन कॉन्फ्लिक्ट एंड मिलिटराइजेशन। पेपर 30 इज अबाउट विमेन एज वेपन्स ऑफ वॉर। Women and girls have been used as weapons of war by terrorist organizations as well as by armed forces of a country. Women who are believed to be the source of honor and purity are used as weapons of war. When a woman's honor is violated, it humiliates the man, because historically women are seen as man's property, and this view about women still continues to exist in many countries. So when a woman is raped, it is not just the woman who is affected, but the man is also affected, because she is seen as his property whom he is incapable of protecting. Most often, women are viewed as mother of the nation, since the reproductive quality of a woman ensures the continuity of a particular community. Therefore, if a woman's purity is violated, then the destructive effect is seen on a larger scale, as the nation and its ethnic communities are also violated and shattered. Women who are raped seem to be isolated from the society, and they become undesirable for marriage. Thus, it collapses the family structure and disturbs the overall fabric of a community. In some cases, rape is used as a means to construct male identity during wartime. For example, let us take the case of Rwanda. The Hutu men were often unemployed and less successful than the elite Tutsi women, and thus these men always felt insecure and inferior towards the women. Hutu men started raping these Tutsi women to gain superiority and success during the war. There are some other beliefs in society that raping women will make the male fighters indestructible in a war. Moreover, raping pregnant women is believed to provide more vitality in battles. However, rape during wars have less sexual motives and are more related to concepts of power and threat over other individual or the society. Sometimes, gang rapes are used by combatants as a tool to forge male unity during wars. Therefore, one of the military tactics and strategies in a war is that of rape. Enloe argues that militarized rape is different than circumstantial rape because it is conducted in a context of institutional policies and decisions. It becomes a tool to send threatening messages to the army, and therefore rape can be referred to as a political agency that has an impact beyond the apparent violation of a woman. For example, in the 1990s, Bosnian women were molested and made pregnant by Serb militants in order to increase the Serbian population. During the Bosnian War and the Bosnian genocide, the violence assumed a gender-targeted form through the use of rape. While men from all ethnic groups committed rape, the great majority of rapes were perpetrated by the Bosnian Serb forces of the Army of the Republika Srpska, popularly known as the VRS. And the Serb paramilitary units, who used genocidal rape as an instrument of terror as part of their program of ethnic cleansing. Estimates of a total number of women raped during the war vary. The European Union estimates a total of 20,000, while the Bosnian Interior Ministry claims 50,000. The Union Commission of Experts identified 1,600 cases of rape, while experts connected to the UNHRC provided evidences of 12,000 rapes. The overall rape estimate ranges from 12,000 to 50,000. The International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia, known as the ICTY, declared that systematic rape and sexual enslavement in time of war was a crime against humanity. Although the ICTY did not treat the mass rapes as genocide, many have concluded from the organized and systematic nature of the mass rapes of the female Bosniak, that is the Bosnian Muslim population, that these rapes were part of a larger campaign of genocide, and that the VRS were carrying out a policy of genocidal rape against the Bosnian Muslim ethnic group. The trial of VRS member Kunarak was the first time in any national or international jurisprudence that a person was convicted of using rape as a weapon of war. The widespread media coverage of the atrocities by Serbian paramilitary and military forces against the Bosniak women and children drew international condemnation of the Serbian forces. Following the war, several award-winning documentaries and feature films were produced which covers rape and their aftermath. There has been a long history of women being used as a weapon of war. In 1937, the rape of Nankin, Japanese soldiers raped some 20,000 women of almost every age, including infants. According to Amnesty International, the use of rape during times of war is not a byproduct of conflicts, but a pre-planned and deliberate military strategy. The rape of Nankin has been described by Adam Jones as, I quote, "one of the most savage instances of genocidal rape," unquote. The violence saw 10 of thousands of women gang raped and killed. The majority of conflicts have shifted from wars between nation states to communal and intrastate civil wars. During these conflicts, the use of rape as weapon against the civilian population by state and non-state actors have become more frequent. Journalists and human rights organizations have documented campaigns of genocidal rape during the conflicts in Balkans, Sierra Leone, Rwanda, Liberia, Sudan, Uganda, and the Democratic Republic of the Congo. John Y. Lee argues that a similar tribunal to the ICTY be formed to prosecute the Japanese armed forces for their use of comfort women during World War II. The strategic aims of these mass rapes are twofold. The first is to instill terror within the civilian population with the intent to forcibly dislocate them from their property. The second is to reduce the likelihood of their return and reconstitution by inflicting humiliation and shame on the targeted population. These effects are strategically important for non-state actors, as it is necessary for them to remove the targeted population from their own lands. The use of mass rape is well suited for campaigns which involve ethnic cleansing and genocide, as the objective is to destroy or forcibly remove the target population and ensure that they do not return. Whether civilian or martial rape, the main idea is to exercise dominance and to meet ulterior motives such as exploitation, murder, torture, and so on. It is a means of communicating dominance by rendering one helpless and without control over what intrudes or forces on our bodies. Rape can be considered as a cross-cultural language of male dominance. Claudia Card observes that the ever-present threat of rape from childhood through old age produces a society of females who are generally oriented towards male services. Females animated by the hope of securing male protection as a reward for their services. Females who often feel bound to those they serve through misplaced gratitude for a protection that is mostly only a withholding of abuse. Interestingly, martial rape focuses on binding warrior rapists to one another rather than binding females to males. Martial rape works as a means to develop bonds among the perpetrators and simultaneously remain separated from their family and friends, and in some cases remain alienated from friends and families of the victims they had raped. Accounts from recently surviving rape victims and perpetrators indicate that purposes currently served in Bosnia-Herzegovina include genocide, expulsion, revenge and obedience, and that its ultimate targets are an entire community of people. Similarly, one can look at the same issues involved in the rapes of the Vietnamese women by US GIs and of Native American women by British soldiers. Martial rape can be used as a means of genetic dominance due to forced impregnation, and the child that is conceived out of rape is bound to the biological father who determines his social identity. This kind of rape can also break family integrity, social, political and cultural solidarity by controlling the next generation's identity and jeopardizing the victim's loyalty. Brown Miller states that even if no pregnancy results, knowledge of the rape has been sufficient for many men in patriarchal societies to reject wives, mothers, and daughters, as was reported to have happened to many Bengali women raped by Pakistani soldiers in 1971. Studies have found that rape victims are often enslaved and dispersed and not killed. It is common that women are generally made captives and enslaved for sexual service. In his History of Slavery, Milton Meltzer notes that one primary source of slaves in the ancient world was the practice of taking war captives, who, in a pre-agricultural age, would have been slaughtered. John Rawls observed in a book called A Theory of Justice, I quote, "There may be transition cases where enslavement is better than current practice. For example, suppose the city-states that previously have not taken prisoners of war but have always put captives to death agree by treaty to hold prisoners as slaves instead. Although we cannot allow the constitution of slavery on the grounds that the greater gain of some outweigh the losses to others, it may be that under these conditions, since all run the risk of capture in war, this form of slavery is less unjust than the present custom. The arrangement seems an advance on established institutions if slaves are not treated too severely. In time, it will presumably be abandoned altogether, since the exchange of prisoners of war is a still more desirable arrangement, the return of the captured members of a community being preferable to the services of slaves," unquote. Various accounts of the rape victim have not addressed well the conditions of women who are captivized and always treated as a sex object. Most of the times, men are slaughtered and women are enslaved for sexual service. Let us take the example of Darfur, where rape has been used as a tool of war since 2000. The women of Darfur are ethnic black Africans who have been continually used as a weapon of war. Since 2000, the Sudanese government has been attacking the Darfur women to suppress rebel movements like the Sudan Liberation Army and the Justice and Equality Movement. Rape is used as a political weapon by the government of Sudan in Darfur. Studies suggest that some 40-50% of women in Darfur have been raped. They are kept in detention camps and are continuously sexually abused. women who resisted are killed. Women and girls are gang raped and left with marks on their bodies as symbols of being violated. Women are impregnated with the motive of cleansing Africans from Sudan. The prevalence of sexual violence reflects wider discrimination against women and girls across Sudan. The security forces have targeted women in crackdowns on protesters and for political arrests. As under the public order law, women and girls can be prosecuted for crimes such as wearing trousers or exposing their hair and flogged, in violation of African and international prohibitions on torture and other ill treatments. The crime of adultery, punishable by flogging, fines, and death by stoning, is also used discriminatorily against women. As we have seen from all these instances, rape aims at dominating and domesticating girls and women by the very nature of its act. It tortures, humiliates, tames, and turns a woman into a broken and docile individual. The oppressed condition of women is manifested by violence of men. Honora O'Neill suggests that rape as a form of terrorism has two important aims. The first is that the raped woman is a victim who is used to threaten others with the message of terrorism. They are similar to the people who are killed in suicide bombings. These people are the sacrificial victims who are used to send the message to other targets in order to seek their compliance with the demands of the terrorists. The other aim is to declare the message of dominance, and that is manifested in the form of rape, where women are forcibly exploited and murdered, rendering them totally helpless and subordinated. Rape is a form of terrorism that not only makes women domesticated, but also makes men the immediate victims who are associated with those women. Let us take the example of Boko Haram, which is an organization in which kidnapping has been a central tool for disrupting education in northeastern Nigeria. Boko Haram's name in Hausa, the dominant language in the region, loosely means, quote, "Western education is forbidden," unquote. As such, the insurgent group has specifically targeted and killed teachers, education workers, and students. Boko Haram has kidnapped hundreds of school children over the past 3 years, using them as a weapon of war in order to continue its brutal insurgency in northern Nigeria. On April 14, 2014, 276 girls were kidnapped from their dormitories at government secondary school in the towns of Chibok, Borno State. This attack by Boko Haram was emblematic of the group's tactics of targeting schools, killing teachers, and abducting children for military gains. In late 2012 and 2013, the Nigerian military expanded their operations against the group in Maiduguri and other strongholds. This pushback resulted in a shift in Boko Haram's tactics. The group began to attack schools and to abduct children in order to fill in its ranks. However, abduction is not only committed by Boko Haram. In fact, Boko Haram began kidnapping and abducting women in retaliation to abductions committed by state security forces against family members of their group. From December 2011, the Nigerian police began to detain the wives and children of militant leaders, possibly to put pressure on the group or to bring about negotiations. Between 2011 and 2012, more than 100 family members of Boko Haram militants were arrested, with no evidence that they had taken part in Boko Haram's crimes. Let us look at some of the examples of how women have been used as a weapon of war during World War II. During World War II, German women were victims of brutal mass rapes committed against them by the Soviet soldiers. Polish sources claim that mass rapes were committed in Polish cities that had been taken by the Red Army. It is reported that in Rakow, the Soviet occupation was accompanied by the mass rape of Polish women and girls, as well as the plunders of all private properties by Soviet soldiers. Reportedly, the scale of the attacks prompted communists installed by the Soviets to prepare a letter of protest to Joseph Stalin, while masses in churches were held in expectation of a Soviet withdrawal. At the end of World War II, Red Army soldiers are estimated to have raped around 20 lakh German women and girls. Norman Neymark writes, in the book titled The Russians in Germany, A History of the Soviet Zone of Occupation, 1945 to 1949, that although the exact numbers of women and girls who were raped by the members of the Red Army in the months preceding the capitulation and in the years following, it will never be known, their numbers are likely to be in the hundreds of thousands, quite possibly as high as 20 lakh victims, estimated by Barbara Jor in the book Befreier und Befreit. Many of these victims were raped repeatedly. A female Soviet war correspondent described what she had witnessed. I quote, "The Russian soldiers were raping every German female from 8 to 80. It was an army of rapists," unquote. The majority of the rapes were committed in the Soviet occupation zone, and an estimated 2 million German women were raped by Soviet soldiers. According to historian William Hitchcock, in numerous cases, women were victims of repeated rapes, with some being raped as many as 60 to 70 times. Anthony Beaver describes it as the greatest phenomena of mass rape in history, and he has concluded that at least 1.4 million women were raped in East Prussia, Pomerania, and Silesia alone. Anthony Beaver estimates that up to half of all rape victims were victims of gang rapes. Neymark states that not only did each victim have to carry the trauma with her for the rest of her days, it also inflicted a massive collective trauma on the East German nation. Neymark concludes, I quote, "The social psychology of women and men in the Soviet zone of occupation was marked by the crime of rape from the first days of the occupation through the founding of the GDR in the fall of 1949 until, one could argue, the present," unquote. German women who became pregnant after being raped by Soviet soldiers in World War II were invariably denied the right to an abortion so that they would be further humiliated, being forced to carry an unwanted child. According to the book titled Berlin, The Downfall, 1945 by Anthony Beaver, some 90% of raped Berlin women in 1945 contracted venereal diseases as a result of these consequential rapes, and 3.7% of all children born in Germany from 1945 to 1946 had Soviet fathers. The history of this particular aspect of mass rape of German women by Soviet troops was considered a taboo subject until 1992. Let us look at how rape has been used as a weapon of war by the British. The Italian statistics records that 8 rapes and 19 attempted rapes by British soldiers in Italy between September 1943 and December 1945. Various sources, including the Special Investigation Branch, as well as evidence by Belgian reporters, said that rape and sexual harassment by British troops occurred frequently following the invasion of Sicily in 1943. Although far from the scale of those committed by the Red Army, rapes of local women and girls were committed by British troops during the last months of World War II in Germany. Even elderly women were targeted. Though a high-profile issue for the Royal Military Police, some officers treated the behavior of their men with leniency. Many rapes were committed by men who were either under the influence of alcohol or post-traumatic stress, but there were cases of premeditated attacks, like the assault on three German women in the town of Neustadt am Rubemberg on 16th April 1945, or the attempted gang rape of two local girls at gunpoint in the village of Oile near Nienburg, which ended in the death of one of the women when, whether intentionally or not, one of the soldiers discharged his gun, hitting her in the neck. There were also reports of sexual assaults and offences committed by British soldiers against children in Belgium and Netherlands, and the number of men were convicted of these crimes while they were fraternizing with Dutch and Belgian families during the winter of 1944-45. On a single day in mid-April 1945, three women in Neustadt were raped by British soldiers. A senior British Army chaplain who followed the troops reported that there was a good deal of rape going on. He then added that, I quote, "those who suffer rape have probably deserved it," unquote. In the summer of 1945, two drunken British soldiers stormed into a farmhouse in Klagenfurt with a drawn revolver when there were only two women present. The older of the two was forced to go upstairs, while the other, an 18-year-old girl, was raped by one of the soldiers. What the Boko Haram did was that they turned captives to suicide bombers and had begun to use those they have kidnapped as human bombs. As security tightened around Yobe State, for example, the tactic of suicide attacks usually increased. Boko Haram militants are entering schools and universities in order to carry out armed attacks with AK-47s and explosive vests. A number of those committing such acts are former or current students. On February 9, 2016, two girls set off their explosive vests in an internally displaced camp known as the IDP for those who had fled Boko Haram's violence. The double suicide attack occurred in some camp 80 kilometers northeast of Maiduguri, Borno State, and killed more than 70 people. It was not the first time that the group had attacked any IDP camps. On September 29, 2015, seven were killed by an improvised explosive device, IED, at the Malkohi camp in Adamawa State. To wind up, we can say that women have been used by militant groups who have taken advantage of their gender. So when women are used as decoys to distract security personnel, the terrorist organization is actually making use of the gender stereotype of seeing women as a siren enticing men. Women are also involved in recruitment, as they can easily attract other people into joining terrorist cells. Terrorist organizations also use women because they are not suspected by armed forces. This again reinforces gender stereotypes of women being meek, simple, and non-violent. Terrorists use women to terrorize the entire community, but it is also important to understand that women within the terrorist groups are also being dominated at the same time. Putting women and terrorism into global politics in historical perspective shows that women's involvement in terrorism falls not only outside of gender stereotypes and expectations about women's ideal typical behavior, but also outside of stereotypes and expectations of what we typify as terrorist behavior. Women lead complex lives, both full of agency and fraught with constraints on that agency. The history of women's terrorism demonstrates both that women were participants in terrorist activities long before it became popular to pay attention to them, and that gendered images of women in terrorism are as old and timeless as women in terrorism itself. These are the facts that gives us the background necessary to understanding women's participation in terrorism in the 21st century. With this, we come to the conclusion of this module. Thank you.